Hey, Robin here from Post Professionals. Here, just one chapter from one of my longer videos for easier access. But if you prefer to watch the whole thing in one go, you can find the link either up here or down in the description. Either way, I hope you enjoy, and if you do and it was helpful, maybe do me a solid and give me a thumbs up, or even smash the old subscription button, which really helps the channel. Thanks, and now this. So to start things off, I want to talk about the brand new proxy media management, something I know that I've been waiting for a long time and have requested many times. So it's great to see that Apple is listening. While Final Cut Pro's proxy workflow hasn't exactly been horrible until now, it was mainly just somewhat cumbersome with less options than I think many would have liked. You could, for example, only transcode proxies into ProRes proxy, and it would also always be at exactly half the original resolution, which, generally speaking, is fine, but if you had a lot or maybe very high resolution media you wanted to transcode, that still resulted in a lot of data, something you especially don't want if you need to exchange those files and libraries with somebody else over the internet, for example. Or, say you wanted to leave your original and or optimized media behind on an external disk or server, while taking just your proxy media with you locally in your Final Cut library on your MacBook Pro to edit on the go. Until now, that meant having to jump through a fair amount of hoops, especially because you could only consolidate all existing media at the same time and into the same location. And then you could only work in either original or proxy mode. So yeah, I think you can see there was room for improvement here. And that's what we've gotten with version 10.4.9. Let's look at the workflow in general first. For that, I have this project, which isn't huge, but it's still just over 140 gigs, which could already be too much for a MacBook, for example, that doesn't have a huge amount of internal storage. So let's assume the previously described scenario that I want to take this footage along with me locally in proxy while leaving the original media on an external disk or server at the office. If I select the library in the sidebar and click on the Modify Settings button for storage locations in the inspector, then we can see that the media, meaning all imported proxy and optimized files, are all copied to the library. As an aside, you may notice that now the Final Cut interface has been entirely dark-moded, meaning that this and various other windows used to be light-colored no matter what mode the OS was set to. I'll cancel out of this, and normally I could of course simply choose to create the proxies upon import, but I didn't, so to generate them after the fact, I'll just go into my library and select everything with Command A, but before I transcode, I'll intentionally command-click this C008 clip that I know by the used media indicator at the bottom is being used in this project. That way I can show you a brilliant new option in Final Cut Pro in just a second. Now I can right-click on any one of them and choose Transcode Media. And with that, the new and improved Transcode Media Options window opens. Here, next to the usual optimized media, which in this case I can't select since all my material is already in ProRes 422, I can still select to create proxy media. But once selected, we see what we came here for, namely the additional codec options I see listed below. Either the usual option to transcode to ProRes proxy, or now there's an additional option for H.264. But not only that, below that I even have an additional pop-up menu where I can select from a wide variety of scaling options. Since, as I just mentioned, up until now the only proxy files that could be created were not only highly compressed, but also exactly half the original frame size. But then they aren't anywhere near as highly compressed as H.264, since ProRes is an iframe-only codec with a 10 or even more bit color depth. So in any case, looking in the pop-up menu, we can see we now have the ability to actually create proxy files at their original 50, 25, or even 12.5% their original resolution. Below that, we also even have three up to resolutions that we can choose as a maximum, meaning that if I, for example, chose up to 1920 by 1080, anything above that is downscaled and anything at or below that resolution stays as it is. So also extremely helpful under certain circumstances. But there are still some limitations. To show which ones those are, I'll choose H.264 at 50% and click OK. And bingo. Since I, in fact, have one clip in this library that is HDR, I'm presented with a dialog box telling me that any and all high dynamic range media will in fact be transcoded to ProRes proxy, since H.264 only supports a color depth of up to 8-bit. Meaning, if it were transcoded to H.264 as well, it would lead to unwanted color shifts, and any color corrections applied would be completely off when switching back to the original media. I'll just click OK and let it render. In the meantime, just for general reference, I transcoded to the ProRes proxy at 50% resolution as well, as it's been up until now, as well as H.264 at 50% for comparison. Now keep in mind, as I showed you earlier, the original library with just the original media in it was 140 gigabytes. Now, for that same library, with just the ProRes proxy media consolidated to it, I ended up with a library of just under 8 gigabytes. With H.264, this same library was just 2 gigabytes with no real distinguishable difference in quality. In other words, we're talking about 25% the size of the usual proxies using H.264, and even the transcoding times were almost identical for both versions, coming in at around 14 minutes each for transcoding everything. So one doesn't even have to decide on whether size or time is the more important factor in a case like this. You could even create full-res H.264 proxies and still only have about half the amount of data to wrangle. Of course, depending on the material and your machine, your mileage may vary in terms of time and space. Once finished, I can now go into the view settings for the viewer, as one always has, to switch over to proxy. But you'll see that with 10.4.9, there are a couple of very interesting changes here. Namely, next to the usual optimized option, the proxy setting has changed to proxy only. And now there's also a proxy preferred option. So what is this for? Well, if you remember, I intentionally skipped one of my clips when I transcoded. Now, if I select Proxy Preferred, I have two advantages. One being that even though this one clip does not have a proxy file, it doesn't go offline. But that also means that if I switch to a project that doesn't have any proxies at all, then there too, nothing will go offline either. Because I don't know about you, but I personally found it rather annoying that I constantly had to switch back and forth depending on which project I was using and didn't want everything to go offline. In which case, I in fact even put in a request to have proxy settings on a per project basis and not globally. But this is actually a much better solution in my opinion. So if I go back to my view menu and select proxy only, I can see what I would have seen before this option, namely that one of my clips goes offline. So in other words, if I set this back to proxy preferred, then Final Cut will always use a clip's proxy media if it in fact exists. And if not, it'll default to the optimized or original media depending on what's available. This would also be brilliant, for example, in a scenario where you're having to mix easier to handle better performing media, such as ProRes or maybe H.264, with much harder to handle poorly performing footage, such as RED, Canon RAW, or something like 10-bit Panasonic material, all of which will struggle on most Macs, RED especially. But I should add that there are also new updates for both RED and Canon RAW, which I personally have not yet been able to test and am assuming have been optimized for the Metal framework. So even for them, proxies may have just become less necessary. We'll see. By the way, if you're either in proxy preferred or proxy only mode, and you select or just skim over any given clip in the library, and that clip has a proxy file, then you'll see a small proxy label above the viewer as well as at the top of the clip's information inspector window. This way, one can always quickly recognize if you may be looking at the potentially much lower quality version of the media. But getting back to our little workflow scenario of wanting to leave our original media behind and only take the now generated proxy media with us. What options do I have with 10.4.9? Well, as I explained before, if in previous versions you had already generated all your optimized and/or proxy media, it would all end up in the exact same place, namely whatever location you had defined in the storage location settings of the library. And separating them into different locations after the fact was quite the song and dance. This has all changed. Now, as opposed to earlier versions where clicking the consolidate button for the library would simply offer the options to consolidate optimized and proxy media according to the current settings, hitting the consolidate button for your media in 10.4.9, now opens an expanded dialog window with a couple additional, much more practical options. As opposed to only two options from the previous versions, you now not only have the option to also consolidate original media, but best of all, you can choose where to consolidate to from here. So if your library is currently set to copy your media to the library itself, you don't have to cancel out of here to go to the library settings and change it. You simply go into this pop-up menu at the top and choose whichever external destination you prefer. By the way, there's also a very handy new recent destinations menu item. So if you've previously consolidated any of your media to, say, an external server or folder that is still available, maybe one you use all the time, you'll have quick and easy access to that destination or destinations from here. I don't have any, so I'll just select choose and create a folder on my external disk and call it server. So we can pretend it's going to a server and select that. Back in our window with the options, I can now decide to include original, optimized, and/or proxy media individually. We can also see that with this, the default storage location for the library in general will also be changed to server after doing this. So for starters, I'll select original and optimized, even if in this case both are the same. I'll deselect proxy and click OK. Now everything of that media is copied to my quote-unquote server. Once that's done, just to make sure I'm not leaving any of my proxies behind, I'll click Consolidate again, set it back to my library, but this time only include the proxy media and click OK once again. And this happens. Because again, when I transcoded everything in my library, I intentionally left out one clip. Final Cut's new proxy management knows this, and I get this dialog window telling me that some of my media does not have a proxy version. If my transcode settings are set to H.264, then I am once again reminded that HDR clips will be transcoded into ProRes. This is, of course, brilliant, since I can now simply hit transcode and be sure that nothing actually goes offline once I disconnect from my original media. By the way, this will even pop up if you attempt to consolidate proxy or even optimize media and you don't actually have any at all of either, in which case some would mean none. Once the transcode is finished, I can quit Final Cut Pro and disconnect from my quote-unquote server by unmounting it. Now, if I restart Final Cut and load the same library, with the display mode set to proxy preferred, everything appears online. This, by the way, is also exactly what whomever I were to send this library to, this 2 gigabyte-sized library, would see after opening it, without the need for access to originals or any relinking. But the brilliance of the new proxy workflow doesn't stop there, because there's a not-so-obvious additional change, something that I've been requesting for a while as well, because going through my timeline, you might notice that I have some graphics at the beginning and end, as well as some clips with animations that I made in motion in between, all with an alpha channel. The only thing is that up until now, after having been transcoded to ProRes Proxy, they would have lost their transparency since ProRes Proxy doesn't actually support alpha channels. But at the same time, H.264 doesn't either. So how could this be working? Well, if I switch between optimized original and proxy only, you'll see that with optimized only, the clips with alpha stay online. But with proxy, they do too. All the clips with alpha stay online, even though they couldn't possibly have regular proxies, as I explained. And again, with proxy preferred, everything appears online as well. So what's going on? It's because of a very smart new addition to the proxy workflow. Basically, Final Cut now recognizes media such as this, meaning graphics that support alpha, in this case a PNG, as well as clips in ProRes 4x4, which suggests that these two have or could have an alpha channel. But it also recognizes audio files that aren't transcoded, or rather don't need transcoding, such as WAV files. Since, again, until now, other than maybe MP3 audio, these two would go offline if you lost the connection to the originals for lack of any proxy versions. Again, since Final Cut doesn't even transcode them to begin with, and never has. So how can I be seeing these if I'm not even connected to my original media at this point, and only consolidated proxies to my library? Well, because Final Cut recognizes that these files don't get their own proxies, therefore consolidates copies of the originals along with the other actual proxies. It essentially flags those originals as both original and proxy representations. In fact, it does that right from the get-go, before you even generate any proxies. Try it. Just switch any project with clips or images with an alpha channel or WAV files in it to proxy, and everything but that media will go offline. So no more tedious switching back and forth between display modes. But best of all, I don't have opaque clips that should actually be transparent. Something that could really ruin my day if it happened, and for which in previous versions there was no real fix. So this is really clever and a hugely welcome improvement. By the way, all the transcoding options that I showed you via right-click for transcoding media after importing it into the library are, of course, available in the import window for transcoding upon import as well. The options sidebar in the import window has also been cleaned up and optimized a bit as well. But matters still don't actually even stop there. There are two additional very cool improvements with the proxy workflow that are not quite as obvious. The first being that if I go to relink my media for the library via the file menu, I now have a new submenu with two options. I can relink my original media and my proxy media separately. The big news here is that means Final Cut can now also link to proxies made using other tools, so I'm not limited to the proxy options built into Final Cut anymore. I can make any kind of proxies I like using another app or service and link to them using this new command. For example, I've used Kino to create 10-bit H.265 or HEVC proxies at 50% scale and can now simply choose Relink Files and then Proxy Media. Click Locate All. Navigate to the folder where I saved them. Click Choose. And I can see that all files have matched and just need to click Relink Files. And bingo. With that, I'm now working with the HEVC proxies. If I want to double check to make sure, I can use yet another new addition to the proxy workflow. Namely, I can right-click any given clip. And I now not only have a Reveal in Finder command as before, but also a separate Reveal Proxy Media in Finder command. Selecting that takes me to the folder that I just chose. These, of course, take considerably longer to generate on pretty much any Mac. Namely, almost 2 hours for 720p versions and 5 hours for half-sized, so 2K versions on my MacBook Pro. Again, as opposed to the 14 minutes for the other proxies, but I'm saving even more space should that be something I need. In this case, up to an additional 50% depending on the material. I can even make proxies of my clips that have an alpha channel and even preserve the alpha since HEVC has that option. Unfortunately though, in this version at least, Final Cut Pro won't accept those files as a replacement. Even though they exist in the same folder, Final Cut will still stick to the original since, as I mentioned before, Final Cut has effectively already flagged these originals as proxy, so sees no need to replace them. Something that isn't horrible and probably won't affect the vast majority of people, but it would be nice to have that as an option in the future. And yes, there's one more thing. Last but not least, Apple has made it possible to import proxy media generated by third-party applications via XML. In other words, you could use this to simply send any existing proxy media to Final Cut and link it to an event or project. For example, an OnSet DIT could use a service that transcodes new footage into proxies. That service could then generate the FCP XML that, along with the new proxies, could then be sent to the editor's library and be imported into the correct event. Later, the editor, after receiving the original source media, could then simply relink it separately for output. Pretty cool. Unfortunately, I don't know of any such app or service at the time of the making of this video, but I know that the makers of Kino, for example, are in the process of working this into a soon-to-be-released version, and I'm sure others will follow if they haven't already, depending on when you're watching this. So, was that helpful? Again, if so, then maybe give me a quick thumbs up or even hit the subscription button and little bell to help the channel, which allows me to continue to produce these free tutorials and so you don't miss future ones. For that, a huge thank you in advance, and I hope to see you in the next one or maybe in one of these videos that YouTube thinks you need to have seen as well. Either way, until then, take care.